All right.
So in my opinion, one of the most pressing issues of the 21st century is going to be taking or replacing non-renewable energy sources such as oil, natural gas, and coal, and replacing them with renewable energy sources such as wind, solar, and hydroelectric. Now, in my opinion, solar is the way to go, and it's the most promising. The reason for this, so if you take a day like today where it's nice and sunny, and you take all the energy that hits the surface of the Earth, and that grand total is going to be more energy, or is going to be greater than the energy needed to power the entire Earth for an entire year. And so while this seems fantastic, unfortunately, going from solar to electricity is really inefficient, and that mainly stems from the solar cell. And so at its simplest, a solar cell is an active material, let's say silicon, that absorbs sunlight, and then two contact layers that separate charge, sandwiched in between a transparent layer and a reflective layer. And so in our lab, we are really interested in looking at different active materials. And so these active materials have requirements such as they need to be easily synthesizable, they need to have high solar to power conversion efficiencies, and they also would ideally absorb light within the visible range. And so while silicon is a highly studied material, other emerging classes of materials have been recently proposed, one of which is the lead-headed perovskites, and the structure you can see here. And so what I really want you to take home today is 2 points, mainly regarding this blue sphere of this cation. And the identity of this cation can modulate the wavelength of light that's absorbed by the solar cell. And the second one is that the size of that cation the structural stability of the perovskite is dependent upon the size of the cation. So if it's too large or too small, the structure is unstable. And so this really limits the feasibility of lead-headed perovskites in terms of direct synthesis. So my research is focused on taking known lead-headed perovskite templates and then using cation exchange to selectively target this blue sphere, leaving everything else, putting something in smaller or larger, hopefully thereby generalizing a synthetic method to expand the range of known lead-headed perovskites.
So I'm going to take you back to a time in your life when you had some idea that you're really proud of, you're really enthusiastic about, but you had to trash it because it was just not feasible. So that was me, a mechanical engineering undergraduate student, coming up with all these cool ideas to like put into my automotive project, but they were just not feasible and I had to kill them because manufacturing processes could not achieve them. But that was something in the past. We're now in a world where we have 3D printing, and 3D printing can do a lot of cool things. So for example, NASA is working on a project where they're trying to develop robots which can 3D print houses on Mars. So imagine going to Mars in a few years, few hundred years, and having your houses built for you. Similarly, a lot of companies are working on technologies that can sort of print prosthetics, implants that are designed for each patient case. And they help save lives in a lot of different ways. But what we still don't know is how do we teach all these things to people and how do we make them creative using 3D printing in general? And that is where my research comes into play. So I'm going to give you two images. The first one was one I painted in the past, coming up with ideas, not knowing what to do with them. And what my research is trying to do is convert that old self to one where I can use 3D printing to make something out of those ideas. And what we're doing in my research is looking at the creative process, right from identifying problems to coming up with solutions for them, testing them out, and then coming up with meaningful ideas or products using those processes. And trying to see how 3D printing can be taught in ways to make people more creative. And this is not just about undergraduate students in mechanical or engineering in general, but artists, designers, scientists, medical practitioners who can do a lot of cool things with 3D printing. Thank you.
So I actually grew up in a very small village in India where we did not have access to running water. So the only source of water we have is actually contaminated with disease-causing germs. And this problem is quite common in many developing countries. And in fact, it's the second leading cause of death for children. And it's said that one child dies every 2 minutes because of this problem. So today I'm going to talk a little bit about our solution for this problem. And first, let's look at why the current technology is not able to help these people. So imagine you're trying to push water through a hole which is 10,000 times smaller than human hair. This creates a lot of pressure. This is what most of the filters try and do because they have to physically stop the pathogens from passing through. So this needs a lot of energy, and which developing countries cannot afford. So we took a different approach to filtration. We wanted to make a filter which can actually attract the pathogens and capture them instead of physically stopping them. So our solution for this is actually bio-inspired. Turns out plants have been doing this from a long time, and they were evolving for a long time to do this because they have to fight against pathogens. So they do this by using proteins which can stick to pathogens and then kill them. So we wanted to coat our filters with these proteins and give them an ability to attach pathogens. So we actually showed sand can be coated with protein from a seed called moringa, which is widely available in most of the developing countries. So this coated sand, which we like to call as sticky killer sand, can be then packed into filters used for water filtration. So our lab test, we used E. coli as a test for bacteria and MS2 for virus. So we showed that our filters perform very well. They filter almost all the bacteria and virus to give safe drinking water. So currently we are at a point of doing field scale studies. I actually could make a filter in India when I went last time, and it can filter water and make it clear. Thank you.
Hi, so I have a love-hate relationship with antibiotics. Did you know that when we use antibiotics, our body only absorbs 30% and the remaining 70% ends up in our wastewater? However, the infrastructure available to clean our wastewater does not work. As a side note, the WHO estimated that 6 years from now, 3.8 billion people will have limited access to water. This is more than half of the world's population. Agriculture, which uses most of the water in the US, will be negatively impacted. To limit the damages, people have been using treated wastewater that contains antibiotics for irrigation during farming. This leads to the transfer of antibiotics to the soil, where they can transform and become more harmful. Think of this transformation as a superhero becoming a supervillain. To make matters worse, these supervillains can accumulate in our fruits and vegetables, and when we feed on them, they can transfer into our body and make us sick. As a solution, we created a superhero to fight the supervillains. In my research, I used burnt waste to produce a powder known as biochar that removes antibiotics from water. Think of biochar as a magnet capable of attracting and holding onto the antibiotics, leading to their removal. So the way it works is antibiotics are drawn to the biochar surface. If the biochar surface is full, it has a sensor that lets it move to a free biochar surface, just as your GPS is able to reroute and show you the way with less traffic. With this technology, we aim to clean water while simultaneously reduce waste and at the same time improving the quality of crops. Thank you.
Hey everybody, my name is Calvin Yeager, and while my start in science began as I was chasing salamanders around in the redwood forests of California, it's developed into an interest in disease. One of the most famous eradicated diseases in the United States was poliovirus, and though polio, once paralyzing 50,000 children a year, is gone from most of the world, there are a slew of cousin viruses that cause the same disease. One example? Enterovirus D68, which paralyzed 150 children in the United States just last year. And for each child paralyzed, there are actually 1,000 other infections that aren't symptomatic but allow for that circulation. So the ultimate goal of my research is to eradicate viral paralytic disease affecting children. Viruses like polio are relatively simple, made up of two major components, a protective shell and instructions inside to make more viruses. Those instructions have to be inserted into that shell by a viral machine not found within the human, made by the virus, that is capable of loading them inside. This machine is a great target because it's really similar between different viruses of interest. So think about it this way. There's a villain in their lair that wants to send an email that contains a malicious program. The email is like the protective shell, and the program is kind of like the instructions to do something bad. And the attachment feature of your email is what's responsible for loading that program inside. So what I want to do is prevent that program from being attached to the email. By understanding this viral machine, we can start making antivirals that would not only be effective against things like enterovirus D68, but any similar virus that rises up to take its place. Understanding this viral machine is the next big step to eradicating viral paralytic disease affecting children. Thank you.